I'm happy to be a part of this IIS initiative and the teaching program. And today I shall be speaking on the steps of an ACL reconstruction. We all know that anterior cruciate ligament injuries are extremely common during sports. These could be contact or non-contact. However, over years, we have also realized that it is not only during sports, but even during accidents of daily living, domestic accidents, as well as road traffic accidents, that the ACL is injured. We need to remember that these ACL injuries can be low velocity and high velocity. And whenever you have a high velocity injury, you must always suspect that additional structures are likely to be injured. So do not look at the ACL in isolation. 15 to 20% of our patient population may require an additional procedure to address associated injuries with the ACL. So right from the time of examination to imaging, one should also look at the associated or concomitant injuries when you assess an ACL injury. We all know that in a symptomatic ACL deficient knee, if a patient continues to have repeated buckling episodes, it results in secondary meniscal lesions, chondral damage, stretching out of secondary restraints. Basically, it's a disturbed kinematics of the knee, which results in progressive wear and tear and eventually traumatic arthrosis. And to stop this deterioration of the knee, for symptomatic ACL deficient knees, anterior cruciate ligament reconstruction is advisable. However, all patients with ACL insufficiency do not need surgery. If patients don't have symptomatic instability and have a well-compensated ACL deficient knee, or if a patient is willing to modify his lifestyle, you do not need to advise them to undergo surgery. Also, if you have a neglected long-standing ACL with already traumatic arthrosis, then an ACL reconstruction is not going to serve its purpose. When we talk about ACL reconstruction, the goals of ACL reconstruction are basically to restore stability to the knee, restore the normal kinematics to whatever extent possible, and near normal functionality of the knee. And to do that, you need to consider factors like anatomy, biology, and kinematics of the graft that you are putting it. It is basically like an internal bracing of the knee, where you want a strong graft, which is precisely positioned at the anatomic location. You want to avoid impingement during motion. So the impingement could occur at the intercondylar notch or between the ACL and PCL, and that needs to be avoided. You also want to preserve biology to whatever extent possible. And this graft, which has been passed inside the joint, should be securely fixed. So these are the four basic factors which need to be addressed during an ACL reconstruction. None of these should be short-circuited. You should respect anatomy so that you do a footprint reconstruction of the ACL. You must preserve biology to whatever extent possible. You must have a strong construct both from the point of graft and fixation. And one has to address associated or concomitant deficiencies that may be in the knee. Only this can give you an optimal outcome of surgery. As we have seen increasing number of ACL reconstructions, we have also seen increasing number of failures. And the reason 70% of these failures can be associated with technical incompetence or technical decisions which are not correctly taken. And one of the decisions that a surgeon can go wrong with is operating on an acutely injured knee. I think timing of ACL is important. One should not operate on an ACL when the knee is stiff, swollen, and painful. And no ACL should be operated without a proper prehab. So why not operate on the acute ACL? Basically, it allows collateral injuries to heal, bone bruises to settle down, the inflamed joint quietens. It allows partial healing of the ACL or scarring down of the ACL. And without prehab, one cannot really assess whether the ACL is asymptomatic or symptomatic. Now, to perform surgery in sequential steps helps in many ways. You know that you are not missing out on any of the lesions. And if you perform surgery in sequential steps, I think your outcomes can be optimized. So the first thing that one must do is don't rely on your clinical examination and MRI findings. It's very important to do an arthroscopic round before you harvest the ACL graft. It gives you a lot of information. First of all, you know whether the ACL is responsible for the instability. We have seen meniscal ACL mimics. For example, as you can see in this case, there was a lateral meniscus discoid which was stuck in the intercondylar notch and it presented like an ACL deficient knee. The MRI too had suggested a sprained ACL. Now, if we would have harvested the graft, we would have found that the ACL was intact and this would have been a futile graft harvest. The next thing you want to know or you can get information on during a diagnostic round is the type of tear, because the ACL can be a mid-substance rupture, it could be a femoral side detachment, it could be a nodule of the ACL. You would then know whether this ACL is repairable or you need to reconstruct it. And then the type of graft that is required depending on the remnant of the ACL tissue. You should also, at this point, assess the associated lesions, because we have seen that almost 14% or 15% of patients have associated lesions like a ramp lesion or a lesion on the lateral compartment of the knee. Also, one can make a decision as to whether you need a graft which is large or smaller graft weight do. If you have a significant remnant of the ACL, then your graft size need not be big. If you have a larger footprint, it may necessitate a bigger graft. And you also know whether you need grafts for associated injuries like the posterolateral corner or the popliteus that will influence your graft options. So here is a video which shows you that how to approach the ramp lesion. One gently passes the scope between the medial femoral condyle and the anterior cruciate lesion, the posterior cruciate ligament, and approaches the posteromedial corner. And ramp lesions are basically meniscocapsular separations, which are seen in this area. One should not be a bone patellar tendon bone or a hamstring or a quadriceps tendon ACL reconstructor. One should have detailed knowledge of how to use any type of graft during an ACL reconstruction. You can, because you may find that you have harvested the graft, it is inadequate, a hamstring graft, and you may have to shift to the bone patellar tendon bone or the quadriceps tendon. And therefore, one should be familiar with all kinds of graft harvest. In this video, we are showing you harvesting of the hamstring graft. When you harvest the hamstrings, make sure that you lyse the dense bands, aberrant bands, which run between the semitendinosus and the medial head of the gastroc. If you do not lyse these, you may land up with a short amputated graft. Once you have the graft, you need to find out whether the graft diameter and length is adequate. If you feel that the graft diameter is inadequate, one can augment these with synthetic material like high density polyethylene tapes, as is shown in this video. Notchplasty is not required in all cases. It is dictated by the type of notch and whether the notch is stenotic, and should not be done routinely as a part of ACL reconstruction. So this is a case where the notch is extremely stenotic. As you can see, there are osteophytes which are narrowing the notch. And here we have used a burr and then a bone cutter, and one can now see right up to the posterior margin of the intercondylar notch. It is only when you can see this area can you select your femoral isometric point or the anatomic footprint of the ACL. Although we all know that ACL needs anatomic precision, it does not mean that you have to go overboard looking at these anatomical footprints. And one should not shave, curate, burn or ablate tissues in search of some imaginary ridges or trying to be too precise. Because if you try to go overboard with precision, you will end up damaging biology, which is a critical part of an ACL reconstruction. So the femoral footprint is supposedly the most important because majority of the errors occur on this side. You want a femoral tunnel which is has coronal obliquity because that can improve rotational control after an ACL reconstruction. You do not want a vertically placed ACL because as can be seen here, the ACL graft being vertical cannot obliterate even a minor degree of pivot shift, and therefore obliquity of the ACL graft is extremely important. So here are different ways by which you can create this oblique femoral tunnels. If you don't have instrumentation, you can do it by eyeballing. Here we have seen that here you can see we have passed an owl. We have located the femoral footprint and we have made a perforation at the anatomic site. We then replace the owl with a bead pin. The bead pin is directed towards the anterolateral aspect of the thigh. And you can see the penetration of this bead pin and the lateral cortex. Once you are happy with the positioning of this bead pin, you can then dilate with the appropriate size reamers, and then with a 4.5 reamer, if you are going to use any kind of distant fixation devices like an endo button. So this is how you can drill the femoral tunnel by eyeballing. Another method is by using a transportal over the top drill guide. And this is similar to what you saw. Even if you have a jig, you can make mistakes. So one must be careful where you are placing the jig, and proper positioning of this jig is extremely important. The third method is by using flexible reamers. And in this, you see that there is a special jig which is introduced from the anteromedial portal. This jig allows flexible nitinol wire to be introduced. And the jig is placed under the remaining fibers of the ACL. As you can see that there's an arch above the wire that you have introduced. And then the appropriate size reamer is progressively used. The tibial tunnel also, and placement of the tibial tunnel can be messed up. The tibial tunnel could be too far anterior or too far posterior. It could also be too far medial or lateral, and you could encroach on the articular cartilage. And the ideal tibial tunnel should be just lateral to the medial tibial spine and in the region of the posterior margin of the anterior horn of the lateral meniscus. And these are the steps to create a tibial tunnel. You can identify the tibial footprint. You then pass a jig, which is almost like a footprint jig. The horizontal lines on this jig are in line with the posterior margin of the lateral meniscus anterior horn. And the vertical lines give you the trajectory of the ACL graft. The K-wire is then passed in the right direction. The tunnel is cleaned up before you pass the graft, and this is after graft passage. So this is an ideal positioning of the tibial tunnel, a video of the same. Very often, if you are not satisfied with the positioning of the K-wire, one should do what is known as serial dilatation of the tibial tunnel. In this case, our tibial diameter was 9, the graft diameter was 9. We have drilled the tibial tunnel with a K-wire initially. then over drilled it not with a 9 but a 7 millimeter cannulated drill, and then followed it up with a 9 millimeter cannulated drill. This allows you fine tuning or precise placement of the tibial tunnel without making the mistake of encroaching on the articular cartilage on either side. The Samba technique is also a technique in which you preserve the native stump of the ACL. And here you can see the shaver coming through the tibial tunnel, and what you see is something like a Samba dance, and hence it is called the Samba technique. But basically what it emphasizes is preservation of the native ACL. There are various fixation options that one should have and be familiar with. You could have a fixed loop on the femoral side. You could have an adjustable loop. If you have a cortical blowout, you need to have options like the extendo or the direct endo button direct. Or if you are fond of screws, then you should have in your armamentarium various types of interference screws that you are familiar with. Ensure that there is a smooth passage of the graft because especially when you are using soft tissue grafts, you don't want them to be lacerated in bony tunnels. So your graft passage should be extremely smooth. Once you have fixed the graft on the femoral side, the knee should be cycled repeatedly to take away the slack from the remaining from the ACL graft before you tighten the tibial side. So fix the graft on the tibial side. Make sure that there's no impingement of the graft as you cycle it through flexion and extension. When you are using adjustable loops, make sure that you can visualize the exit of the button on the lateral cortex, as can be seen here, to make sure that the button is not lying in soft tissue but is against the lateral cortex. So doing it under vision definitely helps. This is a video which shows you how you can do biological internal bracing or a completely biologic ACL reconstruction. A flexible reamer is being used here to drill the identify and drill the femoral tunnel. So you can see a majority of the soft tissue has been preserved in this case. Once the femoral tunnel has been drilled with the appropriate size drill, the tibial tunnel is then drilled at the tibial footprint. This loop is retrieved from the tibial footprint and the graft is passed. And this is the final appearance, which shows you that the fat pad has been preserved and the ACL graft is intact, is at the right anatomic site. So the key points in ACL reconstruction, which I would again like to emphasize, is that never harvest the graft before a diagnostic round. Do not perform notchplasty as a routine. Be meticulous during graft harvest and be familiar with all kinds of grafts. Do not be obsessed by footprints during an ACL reconstruction. Simplify both your femoral and tibial tunnel placement and the drilling. Graft passage should be smooth, and different fixation options should be readily available. Also, the key point is make sure that you address other deficiencies in the knee and don't be focused only on the ACL reconstruction, and follow a customized rehab program for optimal outcomes after an ACL reconstruction. Thank you very much.